All right, so this week I have the pleasure to announce Pavel Exner from the Doppler Institute, who will talk to us about the discrete spectrum of Dirichlet Laplacians in spiral-shaped regions. So, Pavel, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Jean, and thank you for the invitation to this seminar, to this nice seminar, I would say. This seminar is about, a relation between geometry and spectra, as the title suggests, what we do here in the clouds. But what's amusing is in how many ways, possible ways, you can do that. And I'm going to speak today about something which I believe did not yet appear at this seminar, which is Dirichlet regions which are infinitely long. And as a reminder, let me start with something trivial. So if you take a plane and a strip in that with Dirichlet boundary, so as long as it's straight, it's a trivial problem. Of course, you find the spectrum by separation of variables. But then when you bend the strip and keep it, of course, asymptotically straight, then to your surprise, you will produce a discrete spectrum. There is an effective, attractive interaction caused simply by geometry. It's a purely quantum effect. And of course, it's just one example, and there are many similar examples, extensions to this result, to other dimensions, to other geometric settings. There is a lot, and I can only refer to the book we wrote some time ago with Hynek Kovařík. But of course, the case when the strip is asymptotically straight is not the only one. There are other cases, say, periodically curved strip. But there is one class I'm going to discuss today, which was not addressed much. And this is the situation where the strip is coiled into a spiral. That is a spiral-shaped strip, and the boundary would be Dirichlet. The question is, what is the motivation of such a problem? So there are several possible motivations. One is, of course, physics, because in physics you often find systems in which the particle is confined to spiral-shaped regions. Just I present here random selections of papers in which spiral regions are used as waveguide for cold atoms, even its practical application to gyroscopy in electromagnetic systems, detections of nanoparticles, spectrometry, and even its acoustics, even if there, of course, it's a Neumann boundary condition. But of course, there is also a mathematical reason why to study such problems. First of all, these physical waveguides are, of course, finite, but we will study an infinite length of the spiral. And it is not just a mathematical license, but it is also to tell us that some spectral properties have a truly global character. To illustrate what I have in mind here is the following. Let me, for comparison, take a system in which I'm in the plane. I put a Dirichlet condition in a family of concentric circles, which are radially periodic, radii or something like that. And the spectrum of such a system is, of course, easily found. And it's funny, it's dense pure point in the positive part. And in addition, there is a discrete spectrum, which some people called Welsch eigenvalues, which is infinite and accumulates as a threshold. And now, if I replace these circles by a spiral, an Archimedean spiral, and look at this boundary far from the center, they look almost alike. But if, as you will see, the spectrum will be completely different in this case. So let me start with a case study. Let me take an Archimedean spiral, which is conventionally written in polar coordinates, as a linear dependence between radius and the angle. And consider a region which is the complement of the spiral into the plane. And the operator I will consider would be the Dirichlet-Laplacian with the boundary on the spiral. Of course, one immediate observation is that the slope here, the parameter A, is in fact irrelevant because the Archimedean spiral has a scaling property. If you change A, you get the scaled spiral. So I can choose whatever I wish. Often it's useful to choose A equal to 1/2. And if I choose another one, then I multiply the scale by the linear thing, the energy by the one of the square of the scaling parameter, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if I write it in this in the polar coordinates, then of course I can pass to the L2 space on a skewed strip that is on a vertical axis IFR, on the horizontal IS, and the spiral is a skewed strip, something like that. And then, of course, I have to ask what's the domain of the operator is. Now, since of course the Archimedean spiral has this end, which is a non-convex end, so the domain is not just the Sobolev space, but it contains a singular element, which is given like that, because the angle of the corner is 2π, and it's also a quite standard thing. But now, having these polar coordinates, of course, I can pass to the modified polar coordinates. I take away the Jacobian, and in that case, of course, my operator will change, will look like that. And I can also write down the quadratic form associated with this operator. It's again easy to write it. The domain are H1 functions on the skewed strip with the additional singular element at the origin, which is given by such a function. Now, the first question is about the components of the spectrum. So the essential spectrum, the first claim, it cannot find itself below this quantity here. This is easy to see. As I said, you can for proofs, you can choose A whatever you want, choose 1/2. And then I put a Neumann boundary in the vertical region. In that way, I cut a compact part, which is irrelevant for the essential spectrum. And in the rest, I can estimate my operator, because now in the horizontal region, I'm between two Dirichlet boundaries, or if I'm close to the Neumann cut, I have an interval when I have Dirichlet and Neumann. So if I use this fact, I can easily estimate my operator. I mean the cut operator in the infinite part of the strip from below by such a combination. And of course, since I have choose the cut as far as I want from the origin, then it gives me this inequality here. Now the question is, so this is the threshold of the continuous spectrum. Returning to the motivation, I said that if I bend the strip, I will produce a discrete spectrum. So here, of course, my spiral strip is bent. So the question is, there a discrete spectrum? So in order to find that, you can ask about the positivity or non-positivity of such an expression, which is the quadratic form associated with my operator, shifted by the value which corresponds to the threshold of the essential spectrum. So let me estimate this expression from below. I have an explicit expression, and if I estimate the angular part, I easily find that this is estimated from below by such an integral expression. This comes from the estimate of the integral theorem in the interval 0 infinity. And of course, the contribution to this expression, to this form, from different parts of the real axis can be estimated separately. So it's easy, for example, to find that if the interval here starts from the value at least 2 pi, then this expression would be positive. And similarly, if this interval is close to zero, in particular, if it's between zero and pi, then the contribution is also positive. So the only chance to get it negative comes from the interval between pi and 2 pi, which is a compact region, which immediately tells you that you would not have something like the infinite series of Welsch eigenvalues. You will have at most a finite number of discrete eigenvalues. In fact, I will show you a strong evidence that there are no bound states in this system. But now, before coming to that, let me look into other properties on the spectrum. And for that reason, I can use another parametrization based on suitable curvy linear coordinates. Some people call them fermion parallel. There are the natural curvy linear coordinates in the system. If I am something which follows the curve, one natural coordinate is, of course, the arc length of the curve. And the other, the orthogonal one, would be the distance from the curve. So if I write the Cartesian coordinates of the spiral, then I denote as u the distance of the spiral, then I can parameterize the points of the spiral region in this way. And of course, for spiral, it's trivial. It's well known how to compute the arc lengths. It's just this integral here, which you can evaluate explicitly. So in particular, you know that if the value of the angle is large, that the behavior of the arc lengths, asymptotical behavior, is like that, with an error which is of a logarithmic type. And the other quantity I will need is the curvature, which again is standard. You can easily compute and find it everywhere, which is 1/1 of the radius with the error like that. And asymptotically, it's then you can relate the curvature with the arc lengths. Now, with the abuse of notation, I can write the points X as U, just as U. And I know that, of course, this parameterization cannot be used globally, because if you come too close to the origin, in order to parameterize this thing, you need that if you drop the normal from the spiral towards the center, then you have to hit the previous coil. And if the angle is too small, then it does not happen. But for properties which depend on large values of the angle, this parameterization is quite fine. And you find that there is a critical angle somewhere between 3/2 of pi and 2 pi. So for angles larger than TZO, this parameterization is fine. Okay, so that's what I just said. And now the question is, what's the width of the strip? Because you know that if you take the normal going towards the spiral and going towards the center, it is not the same as you take the radial if you take the width of the Archimedean sphere in the radial direction. They're slightly different. in order to find what's the perpendicular width of the strip is, you have to solve the equations like that. Yeah, that's the spiral coordinates. And this is the coordinates of the spiral at the previous coil. The angle is theta minus, which leads to equations, which you rewrite it like that. It's an elementary exercise. And you will find that you can solve it, but first you can estimate the transverse width because you can find easily what the angle is between the radial normal and the tangent to the spiral. It gives you a lower estimate of the width of this type depending on the angle, and you can in fact prove that this asymptotically this is the right value. Namely, if you take that the value of the angle when you hit the previous coil is in fact the angle minus 2 pi plus some small quantity, and the quantity which gets smaller as the angle gets bigger, then you find that you can find the expansion of this quantity in terms of theta. And I will not write the formula. I will write rather what I will need here, which is pi square over square of the quantity, because this is a Dirichlet contribution to a transverse Dirichlet contribution to the energy. It's like that. This is this value, which is the transverse of the essential spectrum plus such a correction. Now, the standard trick, the result I mentioned at the opening, that is the existence of the discrete spectrum when you take a strip and bend it. It's obtained exactly using such coordinates. The trick is that you straighten the strip, you rewrite it in these coordinates, and doing that, you will transfer, you translate the geometry of the problem into the coefficients of the equation. You get the transformation is quite standard, and the result is that you work out the potential which is given by the curvature. It's something which is in the leading order is the squared curvature over 4 with the minus sign, and extra terms which correspond to the which are given in terms of the first and the second derivative of the curvature. But this is under the condition that, this gives the bound state under the condition that the width of the strip is constant. Then, of course, this transverse contribution is just a number, and you will get effectively a one-dimensional Schrödinger operator with an attractive potential. But now this is not the case. Our width of the strip is maybe asymptotic constant, but it changes with the angle. So we have to pay attention to that. First, I use this parametrization to prove that not only the threshold of the the essential spectrum is this quantity here, but the essential spectrum is this interval. In order to that, you use the Weyl criterion. You need the construct a suitable Weyl sequence, and you just take functions naturally, which would be the transverse eigenfunction, a plane wave, and a modifier. And a modifier would be something which would be constructed using an infinitely smooth function with a compact support, which would be, say, in the interval 1 and 2. So then I take this modifier and I add the scaling parameter. So of course, when lambda goes to 0, this modifier gets smoother and smoother, and the contribution of this thing is smaller. Namely, if you take the norm of this function, you'll find that it is the norm of the modifier with this power of the scaling factor. And you have to compare it, of course, with such a quantity to see that the points k square belong to the, or k square plus one belong to the spectrum. Okay, so it's a bit complicated computation, but in fact not that difficult. And as a result, you will find that this ratio is O of lambda, so it goes to zero. And by the standard Weyl criterion, it means that the value 1 plus k square for any k belongs to the spectrum. And moreover, since I choose my modifier with a compact support, so I can choose a sequence of such functions which support of which do not intersect, which means that the sequence converges weakly to zero, and the points belong indeed to the essential spectrum. Okay. Now, so that's what I just said. And before coming back to the discrete spectrum, one more property of the spectrum. The question is about its continuity. I told you that in the example I used for a comparison, the spectrum was dense pure point. Now, what will happen here? Of course, you have to exclude the transverse thresholds. You have to exclude the points where in the straight strip, the multiplicity of the spectrum jumps because more channels appear open for transport. So you exclude these points there. And the claim is that in any interval which is separated from this threshold, the spectrum of the Dirichlet-Laplacians is purely absolutely continuous. Now, how to prove that? The idea is to use the Moore's method, that is to find a suitable conjugate operator. And the conjugate operator I choose here will be just such a thing, which is a generator of the scaling transformation. If this is called A, then E to IA is a group of dilations of my skewed strip. And looking into that, I will not go here into technicalities. You will prove that this function, this operator valued function, has a needed regularity, and then you have to do is to compute the combinator of your operator with the conjugate operator. Now that's an easy exercise. You will find something which looks like that, and then you see that if you sandwich this combinator between spectral projections of my operator, I take the operator which has a cut. I cut the central region where I cannot use the parametrization of this. But since I am interested in the asymptotic properties, I can exclude any compact region I need. So I take this thing and I find that this sandwich combinator is larger or equal a multiple of the spectral projection, which is exactly what I need, because Moore's theorem tells me that in that case, the spectrum in this interval I is absolutely continuous. In fact, the full Moore's theorem says if there is a compact part here, then there may be discrete eigenvalues embedded in the spectrum, but here the compact part is absent, so the spectrum is purely absolutely continuous. But now, back to the question about the existence of the discrete spectrum. So a naive guess said that if I bend the strip, I will produce eigenvalues. So if I bend it a lot, which a spiral of course is, you can expect that the number of eigenvalues would be large. And it doesn't seem to be the case. So why so? So let's look at the operator. Again, I cut it, I cut off the central part. And now what I will have here is that the operator would be estimated from below by the part which is the longitudinal kinetic part. Then there is a curvature induced potential, and there is a part which comes from the transverse Dirichlet contribution. But as I said, this is not constant. It depends on the point where you take the vis. And then I compare the two things. I compare the expansion of this effective potential W, which I compute explicitly. Here I have a result of machine computation because I was simply unable, or we were simply unable to compute up to the sixth order. And I compute the contribution of the transverse Dirichlet contribution to the energy. And I see that there is something here, which is a threshold of the essential spectrum. And now look, there is this point here and this term here. They are the same with the opposite sign. So in this potential here, they cancel each other. And even better, if you look at the next two terms, you see that they almost cancel, or they cancel in the average. So the first non-trivial contribution comes only in the fourth order with respect to the angle, if I write it like that. So this the second order here is absent. This has a zero mean. So here is the first significant contribution, and this is not enough. This might not be enough to produce a discrete spectrum. Okay, so but now the claim I made that the spectrum might be empty is still not proved. So in order to show you evidence that this is a case, let me now modify my problem. I take now the same problem but with a cavity. That is, I will erase a starting part of the spiral. I will take the angle going not from zero, but from some angle, fixed angle beta. So I take again the spiral and I I made a cavity in its center. And my operator will be again the Dirichlet Laplacian like that. So nothing changes with the essential spectrum because that's the property which is given by the behavior at large distances. But here I can estimate, I can expect that if the cavity is large enough, that the discrete spectrum would be present, because I have an easy bracketing estimate. If I put a additional Dirichlet boundary at the circle which is inside the cavity. And of course, if this operator has a discrete spectrum, the original one would have a discrete spectrum too. And this gives a simple estimate, which tells you that if the cutting angle, if the erasing angle exceeds this value here, two times the first zero of the J0 Bessel function, which is something like that, then the spectrum is non-empty. And moreover, the same estimate gives you a condition under which there is a fixed number of eigennodes. Namely, if you take now, this is the first term, and now you start taking the other multiples of Bessel zeros. If the index of the Bessel is not zero, then you have twice, because then there is a double degeneracy. And then if the beta is larger than nth term of this sequence, then there is at least n eigenvalues. Okay, but now let me show you just to illustrate how good or how bad these results are, some numerical results, because you can certainly solve the problem numerically. Of course, you cannot treat an infinite spiral. All the numerical methods work with finite spirals. But what you cut it with Dirichlet or Neumann boundary, which squeezes your operator between two operators, and looking at their eigenvalues, you have an excellent control how exact your approximation is. Moreover, you can do it in different ways. You can either take the original thing in the Cartesian coordinates, or you can take the polar coordinates. So you can calculate it in two different ways, and you again have a control how well your numerical approximation works. If you have a cavity, of course, in the polar coordinates, You have the Dirichlet boundary here, Dirichlet boundary here. If you open a cavity, you have to replace the Dirichlet boundary at these parts with a periodic condition. That is, you come from here to here, you have the same value and the same derivative here and here. Okay, so now if you do that, here is one result. Here is how the eigenvalues of the such a spiral with a cavity depend on the erasing angle beta. Of course, you see that the eigenvalues are monotonous function with respect to beta. That's what you expect. If you remove the Dirichlet boundary, your spectrum will go down. You see that the first eigenvalue appear at the value which is something like less than 1/2 of pi, which tells you how rough the Dirichlet estimate was, because it's about 3 times better than the estimate we had from the Dirichlet bracketing. But what you also see is that below this value, there is nothing, which is a convincing indication that you reach the original problem, that is beta equals zero, then you will have no discrete spectrum. Okay, you can also look at the eigenfunctions. So here are the first 9 eigenfunctions for some values of 10.5 from numerical reason. And you see that they are here given through the contour plots. And you see that they, of course, obey, as you expect, the Courant nodal theorem. But the only the first 2 are Courant sharp. There is no node here, 1 node, but starting from the second one, there is 1, there is 2, 1 again, etc. So these are the eigenfunctions. You can play with the sink father, and you can modify your problem in still another way. Namely, you take now a multi-arm waveguide. You can, instead of 1 spiral, you can take a finite number, 2, 3 or more, which are periodically shifted in the angle. That is, you take something like that, and you again you can again consider the Dirichlet Laplacian. This small difference is that this problem is simple, because if you take a 2-arm spiral, then it has a smooth boundary. In fact, it's 2 interlocked spirals interlaced, and therefore the domain is just a normal Sobolev domain of the operator, no single term involved. And if nm is 3 or more, then there is an angle at the beginning, but it's a convex angle. So again, the domain is Sobolev. So there is no single component. So now you can do the same. And in this case, you will prove the spectrum starts now, of course, at this value. There is m, which is a number of the arms of the spiral, simply because the spirals are now more narrow. And away of the thresholds, which are that the spectrum is absolutely continuous. But I write this that spectrum is that, because here in that case, looking back at the shifted quadratic form at the beginning, here you can prove that there is nothing below the threshold. So the spectrum is purely absolutely continuous in this case. This is what I have here. Here you can prove, I recall that for the single arm spiral, you have positivity between 0 and pi and 2 pi and infinity. Now the whole thing is positive, so there is no discrete spectrum. Here is again some numerical result for a multi-arm spiral, where you have the 6-arm spiral. You have the eigenfunctions, not all. This is the first, second, fourth, and sixth. What is interesting in this picture is the following. You can look at this nodal picture of the sink and compare it to what we had before. And you see that in this case, the nodal pattern is much more similar to what you see in a disk. I mean, of course, this is not a straight line. This is not a circle. But they're very similar to that simply because somehow the effective boundary, which is given by the transverse energy in the channel, which is now much more narrow, is much higher. So the possibility of enter the channel is much lower than in the single arm case. Okay, but now case study of Archimedean spiral, but this is of course not the only spiral you can consider. There are many more. Logarithmic.
May I ask something?
Yeah, sure.
Do you know anything about the nodal pattern in the, let's say, in the one arm?
Could you speak louder?
Do you know anything about the nodal pattern when you go inside the arm at infinity?
I will come to that. You will see that basically in the arm it's a one-dimensional sink. Yeah, you will see the nodal. Back to the spiral. So logarithmic, Fermat, Poinsot, Atsema, Fibonacci, Theodorus, plenty of spirals. So what I will do here, I will always suppose they are reasonably smooth, that is at least C2. So I exclude some spirals like Fibonacci or Theodorus. And in fact, in the examples, I will always have infinite smoothness. Now, in this case, of course, I can have also a fully infinite spiral, that is the angle goes not from zero to infinity, but from minus infinity to infinity, if the spiral winds more and more narrow towards center. I will mention one example in a minute. So such a general spiral, you can characterize again by the function of R, the radius is a function of the angle. And the quantity of interest would be this sink. It is not the radial width. It's I divided by 2 pi to be consistent with the notation I had in the Archimedean case. And I will consider now Dirichlet-Laplacian. R means the function which determines the spiral. And I can also consider multi-arm spiral, again, a number of spirals emerging from the same point. Now, case I have a two-arm spiral, one usually does, as in the case of the Fermat spiral, you write R square as a function of theta square. And in that case, of course, you have negative radii, which correspond to the points which are pi, which are the opposite side from the origin, rotated by pi. Now, I would call the spiral simple if the function is monotonous, and it will be expanding if it's increasing and shrinking if it's decreasing. And I would call them shrinking if the limit of this quantity A, this rescale twist, is infinity or zero. And of course, the most interesting case would be the one where I'm between these two cases. That is, I have a spiral which I would call asymptotically Archimedean. That is, if the limit of A is some non-zero number. Okay, now I said that you can have spirals which correspond to all values of the angle. And nice example is the Simons jelly roll, something which corresponds to these functions. That is, you have a strip which is gets thinner, and you rotate it so that it covers an annulus like that. And Boris Simon use it to show that Neumann-Laplacian in a bounded region can have a continuous spectrum, which is the property of this system. And it also shows how very different are Neumann and Dirichlet-Laplacians. So the domain of my operator will be again Sobolev plus a singular element coming from the origin. And I can describe the thing in terms of polar coordinates on a skew strip, which now of course has a non-constant in general, a non-constant width. So we can write, I can write the quadratic form, just like that. And I can for a general spiral curve, I can compute the arc length and the curvature in terms of R and its first two derivatives. It's again the textbook material. And I can, because the parallel coordinates, the Fermi coordinates were useful in the previous case, I can introduce them here again. They are, as before, spiral plus the term which corresponds to the normal distance from the spiral. But of course, now, depending of which spiral I do have, in some spirals, it makes no sense at all because it may happen that such a normal never hits the previous coils as it happens, say, with a logarithmic spiral or hyperbolic spiral. But for those spirals, I do not need that because there are other ways. For example, I can easily prove using suitable Weyl sequences that for spirals which are so widely expanding, the spectrum is zero infinity, nothing really interesting. On the other hand, if I have shrinking spirals, then I can use these parallel coordinates, of course, with possible exception of the region around the origin. And for them, of course, then my operator can be estimated from below by such a thing here, where V is the curvature induced potential. And since ds is now in a shrinking spiral goes to zero, then I have potential which diverges to infinity, and it is not surprising that the spectrum is purely discrete. Now, here is an example of the Fermat spiral. Of course, it's a two-arm spiral. It's two interlaced spirals, so I take one arm only. And you see that the eigenfunctions number 7, 15, 27, and 42. And you see that there is something, some non-trivial nodal patterns in the center here. But what Zev asked, if you leave the region, then the pattern is basically one dimensional, like that. So that's the eigenfunction of the Fermat spiral, and you can ask about the number of eigenvalues or the counting function. So one thing I can estimate it, if you take the lower estimate by the width, then you can easily compute the quasi-classical approximation. This is this parabola here. But if you plot it comparing to the real number of the eigenvalues computed numerically, you see there is a difference. And the difference is obviously due to the curvature. So the curvature forces the spiral to have a larger number of eigenvalues. Actually, there is a better result, which I learned only today, because just 20 minutes before the seminar, Michiel van den Berg sent me a copy of his old paper he wrote with Brian Davis in 89. Michiel, if you are here, thank you for that. Where in one example, they computed the heat trace for the spiral shape region, which is of the form theta to the power, which is between 0 and 1, which includes the Fermat spiral. And from heat trace, you can compute the counting function asymptotics. So that would produce, that I guess would produce a better expression of this thing. But if you look at the picture, you also see that there are some oscillations. So there are some more subtle things which need an extra attention. But anyhow, my time is flying fast, so let me pass to the case which is the most interesting, namely the situation where the spiral is asymptotically Archimedean, which means that the limit of the quantity A is a fixed positive number. So then, of course, the essential spectrum is given by this interval in the multi-arm region. Then, of course, it's the natural modification. But the question is about the discrete spectrum. Now, the decisive thing is how the asymptotics look like. That is, whether you approach the Archimedean case from above or from below. Namely, I assume that the asymptotics looks like that, and just to make things simple, I will assume that the function rho is naturally the limit is zero, and I assume that it has the asymptotics of this type for some constant c and the power gamma, which is between one and three. And now my claim is that if this asymptotic, if this coefficient c here in the asymptotics is positive, then such a spiral region has a discrete spectrum, non-empty and infinite. How you prove that? You use again these functions you use to prove the Weyl sequence, to construct the Weyl sequence. To prove the essential spectrum. You don't add the because now you look at the threshold of the spectrum. So you don't add the plane wave, k is zero, and you estimate it. And now, of course, there is something, because once you have the asymptotic Archimedean, the cancellation, which was in the pure Archimedean case, will not happen again. So you have an extra term which comes from the asymptotics, and it is, you compute it, and it's like that. And of course, if C is positive, this term is negative, and it prevails for a large enough lambda. It prevails over this positive term, and you will have a negative value of this shifted form. And moreover, since my trial functions are constructed with the modifier, which is a compact support and scaling, I could make the supports of these functions disjoint. I have an infinite number of orthogonal functions, which means that I have infinite number of eigenvalues. Okay, so in order to illustrate this, let me now look into the interpolation between Fermat and Archimedes spiral, namely something which looks like that, which has an asymptotic behavior if theta is large. Then it behaves like Fermat with some b. If I theta is large, it behaves like Archimedean spiral. And the parameter which controls this asymptotic is of course b, or rather b over a. Since, of course, the Fermat spiral is a two-arm one, so I will consider also two-arm Archimedean to compare it. Now, if you look at the asymptotics, it's asymptotic Archimedean, but the asymptotics is reached from below, which means that the previous theorem applies. And such a thing has an infinite discrete spectrum. Here is explicitly the function rho, which I had in the in the asymptotics. And since C, the parameter, is this B4 to over 8 A cube is positive, and gamma, the power there is 2, so it fits, and I have an infinite discrete spectrum between 0 and the threshold of the essential spectrum, which is A to minus. And in addition, I can compute here the estimate the counting function, which would be low because this effective potential is in terms of the arc length. It behaves like Coulomb, like the arc length to minus one. So I would have in the leading terms the counting function of this type. Let me now remark an interesting thing. If you go back to the physics papers I mentioned, many of them say in the title, the Archimedean spiral, blah, blah. But what the physicists do is not really an Archimedean spiral. What they do, they will take something of a constant width and roll it out, coil it out. But now the perpendicular width is constant, which means that the spiral they obtain is not an Archimedean spiral in the mathematical sense. It is rather, if you look into the behavior, it rather looks like my interpolation with the parameter of this value. And it, of course, makes the difference. But before coming to that, let me say that apart from this interpolation I show you, other spirals may behave differently. For example, if I take an involute of the circle, then I have again the asymptotically Archimedean case, but now the asymptotics is reached from above. So the theorem does not apply, and I suspect that there is no discrete spectrum. The same is for the Azema spiral, where of course the parameter is not the angle, it's related to the angle up to a higher order term. But if you slightly modify the Azema spiral, if you replace this thing here by this, you have something where again the discrete spectrum is non-empty and infinite. So here is some numerical result for my interpolation. If you take now the spectrum as a function of the parameter B, and A is fixed to 1. So then you see that for any non-zero B, you have an infinite spectrum. And you see that it accumulates, of course, we calculated just 9 eigenvalues. And if you go with B to infinity, which is the Archimedean limit, then you finally get the spectrum disappearing. On the other hand, if you have small b, then the Fermat bulge in at the beginning is large, and of course there are many eigenvalues here. And of course the case when, as I said, which correspond to the physicist Archimedean spiral was 0.63, which was here. So you see that in that case the spectrum is infinite, but it's very close to the threshold. Now, if you just as an illustration, here is the interpolation, the 14th eigenfunction of the interpolation case. You see that by naked eye, you do not distinguish it from the Archimedean case. It's almost Archimedean, it seems so. But still, there is a discrete, so 14th eigenvalue is still below 1. It's this quantity here. And if you pay attention and you compute these nodal lines here, you'll find that there is 13 of them. They are getting more and more rare if you go around the spiral. Okay, so now I think I'm almost at the end of my time. So let me, in the remaining time, list some open questions. So first of all, from the physics point of view, you should consider a bit different things. Not only this question about asymptotics, but in physics experiments, usually you avoid the central part. You take the double coiled sink, and the loose end in the center are joined in a S-shaped sink. So that would meet the spectral spectral properties in this in the center different. Second is I created a discrete spectrum in the Archimedean case by erasing a part of the spiral in the center. You can also erase something away of the center. You can make a window in such a guide. And it is known that if you take two guides which are parallel to each other with a common boundary, and you drill a hole common boundary, you'll produce a discrete spectrum. Now, if you do that here and you make the window large enough, of course you produce a discrete spectrum. But the question is whether this will be a case as for any vis, or if whether there is a critical vis of such a window which will produce that. Now, of course, the spectrum, the question is about the simplicity of the spectrum. One suspect that the spectrum is simple, but this is not proven, and the question is whether you can have accidental degeneracies. The other question is, in case if you have a discrete spectrum, about the spectral statistics. In cases I showed you here, the sink was basically one-dimensional. So then you expect that it will behave like a one-dimensional system. But if you have more complicated spirals in which the generating function would be, or the vis derived from that would be non-monotonous, then the question is whether there could be such a spiral-shaped region which would produce a non-Poissonian statistics. Another question concerns the boundaries. Of course, you can have completely different game if you're Neumann-Laplacian, as I mentioned. But if you have other Robin boundaries, then the question is whether you would have the same. So of course, you cannot expect if the parameter of the Robin condition is attractive, you would not expect the positive spectrum. But otherwise, one would suspect that many of the results will be valid if you replace the Dirichlet by Robin boundary. And of course, now, because it's a rotating motion, the natural question, what would happen if you put such a spiral into a magnetic field? And I mean, I don't want to tire you. So the last one, if you, instead of taking Robin, take a transparent boundary you can tunnel through. That is, if you replace the Dirichlet boundary by a delta function with some alpha, so what would be spectrum in that case? Anyhow, so what I told you was basically the contents of the paper which appeared a couple of weeks ago. And having said that, I think what remains is to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Pavel, for this beautiful talk. It is now time for questions. So if anybody has, please unmute yourself. Yes, sure. Go ahead.
Can I ask a question?
Sure. Yes.
I was thinking all the time, what will be the classical analog of such motion? Because you see, if you go with a classical ray from some distance in towards the center, then some parts you touch the next spiral, sometimes you miss it, and therefore there are many diffractions, or it is something between classical chaotic and classical.
That's a very interesting question, which I don't know the answer. What I can tell you is that if you have a strip of a constant vis and you bend it, the fact that it produces a discrete spectrum is a purely non-classical effect, because in such a bent strip, you can of course have a trajectories which go to and fro, but these are those which go perpendicular to the boundary. If you have a non-zero angle, then no such trajectory can stay in a bounded region. So here, of course, the this is slightly changing. So it may produce something interesting. But
you cut me short, Pavel. Please let me finish, because you can also look. Suppose that you add, you finish your spiral with mm-hmm. a tube which goes to infinity. So once you are very far away, then you have asymptotically separable problem. Classically, it means that you can move in a classical way with a incoming ray, and you can ask what is the scattering matrix or the scattering probability, or what is the deflection, you know, what is the final angle you go for as a function of the initial transversal degree of freedom. And that is what we call chaotic scattering. And that will mean something about the spectrum of this corresponding S matrix, et cetera, et cetera. So I wonder if you are so good at doing the spectral problem, if you did also some of these classical scattering problems.
No, it would be, it fits well into the list of my open problems. What I can say that in tubes which are of constant width, the scattering problem can be done too, but it's generally somehow more complicated than the spectral one, than the discrete spectrum. You can have resonances by thresholds and such a zoo, which most probably will be here too, but that's just guess, I do not know.
And there was a question, I think, was by Zev about nodal domains and counting.
Nodal domains. I mean, in the examples I mentioned here, the outside of the central region, the problem became basically one-dimensional. I mean, the asymptotically the variables decoupled. So you have asymptotically the problem in which the transverse part will create an effective potential in which the system effectively one dimensional would move.
You see, because if you look, for example, at an annulus, very thin annulus, then I can show that then the effective Pleyel constant is 2 over pi, mm-hmm. like it is in a rectangle. And I would expect that something will happen here, maybe, I don't know. But it might be quite interesting also to look numerically, but then you need a very large spectrum.
I fully agree. I mean, there is a lot what one can do here.
So if you have a free position as a postdoc, please hire me.
We have just opened one position, but the condition is PhD not older than 3 years. But you have a fresh PhD in archaeology, isn't it?
No, I don't.
Thank you for the questions and answer. Is there anybody else who wants to ask a question?
Sure. Yes, this is Naoki. Yeah. Good to see you, Pavel. Yeah, okay, so I have one question. So in your spiral domain on R2, if you basically, you know, put it in a 3D, like, you know, helix, but not really the helix, but with the same rule, and then what's going to happen?
To be quite frank, I do not know. I suspect that large part of that's I have a much longer list of own problem. This is one of them.
Yeah. Okay, I see.
Because as in the case of just tubes of constant profile, from two dimensions you go to three dimensions.
Yeah.
And you have some effects translate to three dimensions.
Yes.
And then there are other effects. For example, a torsion. So, for example, if you take the spiral and let it change along the then the torsion in three dimensions
is
bound to produce to make the opposite effect, to produce a repulsive interaction.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, this may happen, but frankly, I do not know. I mean, that's the first paper we started it in the middle of the last year, and that's where we managed to come
until. Okay, I see. Yeah.
If anybody comes with results in this direction, I will be very, very happy.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I have a couple of questions. This is Peter.
Hey.
Question one, in your numerics for the Archimedean spiral, I assume that from what can you actually prove rigorously from the numerics? I assume that it's only near the threshold where you have problems. In other words, if there is a bound state, it would have to, those might accumulate at the threshold. That's your enemy?
That's usually the case. The closer you are to the threshold, the larger you have to choose the cutoff of
your right. So I was just wondering if you could actually use the numerics to prove anything. So the only thing you'll prove numerically.
No, Peter. But what I said that we did the computation with Dirichlet and Neumann. So we had a control. That our eigenvalues are really in the interval.
Okay.
Yeah.
The second question was in maybe with Neumann boundary conditions. Is there any situation where you have infinitely many eigenvalues in the continuum, like the much more subtle things which are very unstable?
I know.
Can that happen for spirals?
No, I do not know. I know that there in that example of the jelly roll in the paper you find a claim that there are discrete eigenvalues in the spectrum, but I know nothing about the number of the eigenvalues. But again,
I'm asking if you've ever seen an example with infinitely.
No.
Because, of course, there's something very similar. If you take a hyperbolic triangle with Neumann boundary conditions, there are these examples that go back to Solberg, which have infinitely many embedded eigenvalues. And then, of course, you have to use analytic dilation or something of that nature to try to study them. I'm asking if that happens in spirals.
No idea.
And in your book, which I don't know, open up, as you were describing, which you've studied much deeper. Does it happen there, ever?
We studied there only Dirichlet and Robin case, Neumann.
Neumann. Ah, okay.
Yeah. Sorry, I mean that came from.
Okay, I'll have a look.
We mentioned some Neumann results, but that were basically the results by the others, by Brian Davis and by others. But that was not our main topic.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Very nice.
Thank you for the questions and thank you for the nice answers, explanation. Pavel, is there anyone else who has questions? So I have a very trivial one, I think. You mentioned that physicists are studying these spirals. To a mathematician, maybe it's surprising. Why are physicists interested in these spirals?
I quoted these examples. They used them as waveguides, say for cold atoms, and applications. I found a paper when they make such a spiral sink, a part of a gyroscope, for example. These are all papers where they try to get some, that's a tool. The spirals are a tool, not the main object of the study, I would say.
Yeah, thank you. Anyone else has questions for Pavel? So let's thank the speaker again. Be safe and see you next week. Thank you.
Bye.